We all are tired after 2 days of conference. Maybe I shall start with the fairy tale we have in the Czech language. We have famous children fairy tale, which is about how the cat and the dog baked a cake. It was written by Karel Čapek, maybe you heard his name, of Czech author. By the way, he invented the word robot to the international vocabulary. And those two animals, cat and dog, decided to bake a cake, and they expected that if everybody, if each of them will put there the best it likes, that it will be nice for both. So the dog put the bones, the cat put the mouses, and I have here a picture. You see the cat putting the chocolate and the dog putting the onion. And when they baked it and started to eat it, they found it's horrible. And I think it is the idea of X definitions. We tried to put together almost all what you need if you would like to be happy with XML. It's a technology which started, I think, almost 10 years ago when my boss sitting here brought to my office the pile of sheets because we were working for the car insurance company, and you cannot imagine what you can insure. It can be not only the car, it could be motorcycle, but also tractor and bagger and tramway and train and everything. And for each kind of accident and each kind of insurance, it's completely different sheet with completely different parameters. And my boss was very brave, and he decided to build the system on XML, which is, we are happy, all of us here. And then I was very much afraid how it will work. And it was not much of technologies then available. So he told me, do with that something. It was DTD. In 2001, you couldn't use it. Too much more. So very soon I found out that DTD is not enough. That, well, you can somehow validate the data, but the most important thing is not maybe only to validate, but also to be able to report error, to find out all errors. Some errors are connected with the outside world, with database, with relations inside of the object. So I started with something very simple. I got some form, some sheet expressed in the XML form, and here was some, let's say, insurance, and there was some parameters like car number. So I did something which is more natural. I simply wrote the here's string, yeah? Okay. Here is number, so it's integer, and so on. It's much more readable than anything else. I just replaced the data with the description of data, and of course, very soon I came to the idea that it's possible to write here the occurrence. Let's say this is optional and this is required and so on. And similar thing we did with with elements. Anyway, it's still just the language for validation. And it's quite natural to say, well, what about to write here on error, do something, and to call maybe some external external method or to have some language, some script which is describing what to do. So this is the history of X-definitions. What's the X-definitions? What kind of cake it is? It is a cake which is hopefully for analysts, for system designers, for description, and I think very readable one, description of data interfaces. And because I am programmer, I wrote it, in fact, for myself. So it's also for programmers. And by the way, it's a very special way of programming because you can put the code inside of the object on the place where the data are present. And finally, it is very readable for everybody. And it's very important if you are designing some kind of larger system, especially a distributed system, that you need to communicate with many different kind of partners. And some of them, they are not too much familiar with, let's say, XML schemes or Schematron or RelaxNG and so on. So how to say it for them the most readable and natural way what's in the object. The X definitions can be used for many different things. First, of course, and some people do think it's the most important, and I think it's absolutely not enough, but it is important, of course. It is validation. I think this, the idea I described, it's clear that for validation it's possible to use. But I'm sorry, I must use several glasses. What I tried to describe in the very beginning, it's the tool where you can define some kind of events. Let's say that this happens if it's parsed and it's found that there is an error. It's an event. But there can be other events. The other event is when the whole parsing is finished. So we can define some, let's say, events or stages on the XML, and we can describe what to do in these situations. And I think this is very powerful part of X definitions. We are using it for maybe 8 years, and I think very successfully. It's possible also to use for data processing. I put in the behind the remark that data processing of unlimited size. We have some tricks which helps us to use the really unlimited size of data. We are processing as the XML data, the XML data of size of tens or hundreds of gigabytes. Just as a joke, it was one bug there that we used just the integer for some RBR for some relative pointer, and we just changed it to long int because today 2 gigabytes it's nothing. It's possible to use also for something what we can say the generation of XML. Try to say that you want to generate from nothing, from some other data, from database, or you want to generate an XML object, and you want to be sure that you created the valid and correct object. So the X definitions are able to generate the data and to transform one XML object to another one XML object. As I described in the beginning, it's also possible to use for some kind of programming, which is very special because you put the code inside of the object. So you don't care about the structure of the object. If, if this object is repeatedly somewhere, you don't need to write any kind of cycle. You just put there the code, what happens if it's reached. And finally, X definitions basically are connected with the outside world, because it's just the envelope, and you can call any kind of external functions, either in Java, or you can call the XPath procedures and so on. So now, very briefly, let's have some very simple data. It's some book with title, author, or let's say authors. You will see how we'll write it. So how we create X definition? We first remove all the data, and we have just the structure, and then we put the, as I already described, some description of values we have there. We can add, or we have to add the description of occurrences. And you see now that we are using also the namespace of X definitions just to be able to describe also something what we are, in the case of attributes and text nodes, putting in on the place where that could occur. So we need something to put in the to describe in the element. So we are using for that the special attribute from namespaces of X definitions, and we call this attribute script. So this is, I think, an example of completely simple, readable, and precise definition of the structure. Of course, it's not enough. Here, I skipped this because it's just an example that it can be described explicitly and so on. Now I am coming to the example of actions and events. I already mentioned that you can describe some events. So let's say that we will define the special event when we have no data and we have only this recipe, this description. So we are reading in this mode, in the create mode, we are reading the X definitions and we are doing what's written in the paragraph or in the section which is called create. But we can put together as the cat and dog. Moment, this is what I made. I don't see with this glasses. It is an example of using the XPath and having some. It's great. I saw it already. Great. Thank you. We have here an example of creating one XML from another, let's say some kind of transformation. I think you should like it. And we write here, this is XPath. Yeah? Let's have the structure, the data, which are books. The item, which is called book, is unlimited. There are many books there. And how they are created? They are created from another, from this source, from this item, which is a little bit different structure than the structure of the book in our description. This create from, simply imagine that we have the inline function, which is called from, which does nothing else than executes the XPath on the source. And it puts to the processor something what we call concept, context. In this moment, it puts as a result node list of all items here. Now it's clear. So this book is created so many times. How many items are here? Inside of this object, already the context is one item. Yeah? And when we write here that this element is created from attribute title, from here, we have here title. Yeah? So it is the way how is created the child of the element book. The outers is more interesting because they can be more. One book can have more outers. Sometimes it's so. So we have here authors, and inside of authors in the input data are different authors, and we have again, we made the same. We called on the current context again the XPath. We get all authors, and we create this author from this context. Yeah? I think I have no chance to describe it in details, just I wanted to show you the idea. And I will skip to another slide where it is described that we are really trying to make the cake for everybody. So I'm just demonstrating here that you can write here different, describe different events, and the processor is providing the actions which are connected with events only in the situation when they are relevant. So if we are validating data, which are called book, we are ignoring simply all the create actions because they never happen. They happen only in the mode when we are creating this object. I think it's clear that you can define some user-defined situations and user-defined events, and you can filter what you can do with that. So I think that I will skip this. And quite interesting event is event match. It is very simple. Even match has nothing else behind. The action connected with situation match is only true and false. It must be Boolean. And we can have the description of two different models of element, which depends on the value of the expression which follows the keyword match. The match is processed, or it's invoked before the further processing of model is done. So this way you can describe alternative models. And of course, you can put the, instead of XPath expression, you can put there some external variable or anything which can, according which you can decide which model is valid. So it's another example. I again skip it here. It's example that it can be some variable here. Yeah. It's basically the same. Now I come to quite interesting event, finally, and especially the event forget. Forgetting, by the way, is the most powerful thing in our brain, so we are trying to do the same. What it is, the event or action forget. Imagine that you have 200 gigabytes of data in some input data you are trying to process. And of course, you cannot look to the whole data in the memory of computer. So you can say, after I processed something, I can forget the rest. If you, at the end of some item, put this special keyword, forget, it doesn't mean anything else, then the memory is released and you cannot go back to the data. You have done all what you needed due to actions, but you don't need it more to keep in memory. And finally, it's nothing else that the event finally is processed when the item is here, when the parser comes to the end of the element. So how much time we have? 10 minutes. So I should give the floor to my colleague. So only very, very fast. We have different kind of structures of groups, choice, sequence, something what you know also from RelaxNG mixed. We can describe also the occurrence of the elements inside of those groups, and also we can describe the repetition or occurrences of the whole group, which is important for Norman Welsh maybe. I think I put there some picture which I specially designed for Norman. Here is example how you can make some references between different X definitions. You can make a collection from X definitions. It is example of collection. You can put, of course, some annotation inside. It's just it has the format of comment, of special comment. Here is an example of possibility how you can define the user type, which is here in Java. And what's maybe interesting that you can export from the X definition the models to some, let's say, public pool. And you can from other parts to refer those public objects. Now we are coming to the jungle of discussion, how to allow to make modifications and different versions of data. So we have something what we call abstract, and you can refer to the abstract description and describe just the changes or what you need to. What is here? Our final dessert is just a real dessert that you can describe X definitions with X definitions. You can, with a trick that you can use the meta namespace, you can describe the X definitions. So now it's here, I am saying just that we have full transformation of DTD to X definitions. No any kind of restrictions. Basically, we can all schemes of and RelaxNG transform to X definitions. We implemented it to Java 1.3 and to J-sharp, and we have some IDE tool in NetBeans. And this is end of my part, and I am giving floor to my colleague George. Do you need microphone?
Yeah. Good afternoon. I will continue in our presentation of X definitions. So the theme of my presentation is a little is connected with X definitions, and I won't say I won't speak about data orchestration above with the usage of X definitions. What I mean with the term data orchestration, I show it on the register of traffic accidents. It's a real application that is, or not application, it's a register, it's a database and set of applications really running in the world. And the X definitions are the one of the basic technology that we used creating the components of these information systems. So you can imagine that by such a large systems, you have a problem with a lot of similar data with different descriptions, with different data objects, with different interfaces, and so on. And you need some order in it, some tools that you help you to maintain some consistency of descriptions. And not only the description, but also the consistency with the programs by the maintenance of the systems. So the goal, so I defined the goal of the data orchestration first, to hold analytical processing and documentary consistency between the data descriptions. Second, to be able to control with this data orchestration project also the behavior of the programs and the processing of data. And third, to be able to stimulate the communication between the client and supplier. It means when you define the object, when you maintain the objects, you must be able to speak with his client. Between the analyst and the programmer, you must be able, the programmer must be able to understand his analyst. Between the analyst and the architect, for example, also, and in the end, the communication between the programmer and the machine. They must understand each other. So, it's what I mean, the data orchestration. Here is some very overview, standard overview of the system, traffic information system, traffic accidents register. He has some applications, online, offline applications. The offline application is when you have a traffic accident, there come a police car, and there will be typed your personal data. Data about your car, and so on. There is a web tire. It's the you can imagine as web services, application tire, database tire, and other applications, for example, statistical tire. So, at what is a data control point? It's another term that I won't introduce. It's the place in the information system where I want to connect my data orchestration with the program. It means where I want to impose that what I want as a client, what I want as an architect, as I want as an analyst, that is implemented in the systems, and I keep a control over these descriptions. There can be different activity that I describe with these data control points. It can be a validation of similar data. It can and validation without the it can be, for example, code list checking, as was described tomorrow by Ken Holman presentations. It's one. Yesterday. Sorry. we need to describe some interfaces. We need, for example, to describe exports of data, some data creation, data input control, and so on. All this we want to describe is the unified technology, and the X definitions are very suitable technology for such a task. Yes, on this picture I want to show you control points, examples of different points. If you have an offline client, SIG client, you need to assemble the data from the, on the place of traffic accident, and you need some validation of this data. So we use X definition to validate the screens or the forms on the level of the assembly from the beginning of assembly of the data. Before you send the whole description of the traffic accident in XAML file, you need to make some consistency check of this. For example, if the policeman has written everything in it and so on. So before we send it to the center, there is in the SIG client also such a, they are running such a consistency test. On the web service style, we make a validation of the XAML contents of the web services. On the application tile, we need to make a consistency check of external code list codes against a database. And on the statistical tile, we need to make many different exports that are controlled through the X definitions. And what is the data orchestration project? No, it's a, for us, tool that enables us to share the communication between different roles. It means people that are working on the project, between the client and user and analyst, between the analyst and the architect, between the analyst and programmer. And is a tool that keeps the consistency of the data descriptions of the whole project, and that export the particular definitions in different control points of the system. So, and here is something that I need to comment in the cat in the merchant about a cat and dog. We need to structure the X definitions into some layers. If you baked the cake, you must bake some level for the cat and some level for the dog. Otherwise, nobody will eat it. So we need to describe the data structure. It's the part where you describe how the XML is structured, what the data types are in attributes, in the elements, and the other side is data processing layer, where you describe the scripts, where you describe the actions that are connected with events by the processing of the XAML files. And at the end, I show two very small examples. One is the abstract model that describes only the structure and syntax of the X definitions. And I think it's not so important now. The other definitions describe the code list checkings. It's referring to the abstract definition. All what is written in abstract definition is valid also for these X definitions, and we add some behavioral. It's when you have some code, a code district, you must check it against the code list in database or the code sex, code driver license, and so on. Thank you very much. The questions. Ask him.
Are there any questions?
Nobody. No questions.
Do you mean that maybe it's good also to repeat the question for the others? You mean that whether you are asking whether X definitions are good starting point for code generation? What kind of code do you mean?
Programming
code. X definitions are implemented as the compiler. The X definition is compiling the code, let's say some Java class or something like that, and it's the program which is described in the X definition is the code itself. Of course, you can do it in many, many different ways, and it's not too complex if you reduce the script inside of the X definition only to invoking of some, let's say, collection of internal methods, which can be very powerful, or to some external methods, and XPath, maybe some other tools. But we need, of course, and it's absolutely crucial for the real usage, we need connection to the external code, which we are usually writing in Java. Basically, it's possible in another one. And this code is providing complex checks in the database, etc. Is there some other question?
It will be for you.
I think I understand what you mean, but it's a dilemma, it's philosophy, and...
Your annotation of a prototypical instance, I think is an interesting model, and I found it interesting in my work with UVL. So for those who are interested in annotating result instances, I would also commend you on that.
Yeah, thank you for coming. Is there some other question? So we have our poster there. After.
I have one question. Is what kind of limitation are you referring to on XML schema? For the first question.
I think that we are able to transfer
XML schema.
Every XML schema to X definitions. Not almost. They are almost. Oh, I mean, on the other side
it's not a problem to fix way how they are creating the how XML scheme is working with the heritage of types and so on. But we are not exactly following the philosophy of inheritance. Yeah? So that's the difference. We are using parameters. We can say this string is limited this way and it's expressed by parameters. If you accept that any type, simple type, is you can describe by a method with parameters, then it's fully transformable. And in fact, the validation method is nothing else than the method which returns true or false. It's checking of the format, of course. It's very simple method.
And the last question is, you say that you want to refactor it. So is there a chance that you reuse some existing vocabularies like schemas
We have transformation because we are working for our customers and some of them wanted to have DTDC. We tried to make the tool which is transforming X definition to DTD, which is basically principally not possible. Not all X definitions are possible to translate to DTD. And we are almost all X definition we can translate to schemes. I think we are able to more precisely to describe the content, the structure than the schemes, I think.
Even the one-on-one.
Basically, if you don't use all features if you have some subset of X definitions, you can transform it to schemes.
Thank you.
We thank you.